Okay, very good Thursday morning for anyone joining either in person or as a recording later on. This week we have been looking at the chapter on the heart, and I thought that what might be the most useful is that we spend a little bit of time discussing the labs that relate to this week's content. That's probably the one element that some of you might find that is worth of going back to. So I'm just going to start by sharing my screen, and what you should be seeing is the view of the learning modules for this course. And of course, my view looks a little different from yours, but at large, there's a lot of similarities. So let me just get to this week's material. And one of the things that you'll see is under the heart lecture and notes on week 4, you will find actually an additional document that I've uploaded there, and that is a handout of some of the key slides from the dissection activity that we completed in the class. So I realize that dissections are very hands-on, and sometimes it is hard to take notes while you're completing the dissection. So I wanted to provide you this resource that really gives the key slides from what I prepared and gives you a chance to come and check on those and refer back to those as needed. So you kind of get not just the theoretical background from the lectures and the hands-on experience from completing the dissection, but something that bridges the two and you still have it documented. So I've generated that, and that's available there for you. As a PDF file, it is the key slides, like I said, not every single slide, because not every single slide necessarily is material that you need or material that you want or that I can publish that we look in the classroom. But these will guide you to the most important steps, so you can kind of remind yourself of what you saw, what we did, and what does that mean. So that's the first thing I wanted to share with you that's available there on the learning module. The second thing that I wanted to share with you that's available there on the learning module is the actual hand-in of the lab assignment. And please remember that I try to do a good job of providing grading rubrics for you ahead of the time, and these grading rubrics are really there to give you an idea how the points are distributed when you're completing an activity. So whenever there is one of those available, I strongly encourage you to make use of it and check that out and have an idea what I'm looking for. I often tell my students that even though you might have different views of what's the correct answer, a lot of the time it does help give the grader what they're looking for. So this is really giving you an idea what the grader is looking for. And one thing that you'll notice is that the heart dissection on its own, really the way to get the points for that is by completing it, and there's very little that you can do independently from home if you didn't attend to the lab session. So unfortunately, that's something that I will not be organizing a reset of a dissection lab. That would just end up being unmanageable workload for everyone involved. So like I've shared in the announcements earlier on, either you attend or you don't. And then if you attend, you get those points for being present, actively participating into the dissection. And again, like I've said in the classroom, I realize that there are many reasons, many beliefs, many ethical standpoints, many other religious convictions and so on, why some might choose to take part hands-on, but you can also participate by taking notes while others are completing the dissection activity, reading instructions to the others, guiding others. So participation doesn't have to be the actual act of cutting into the specimen that you're looking at if you have an issue. And I've encouraged you, we've worked now for a while together. I've encouraged you to speak to me. I'm very solution oriented. So if there was a situation that you felt uncomfortable doing something, I will always try to find a solution to that. So that's just to say that, again, I appreciate everyone who attended the dissection part, and you will get those points automatically. If you didn't get a chance to attend into the dissection part, I would really encourage you to complete the parts of the EKG lab that are parts that you can complete yourself independently. There's few things such as preparing the EKG trays that we did in the lab that I don't assume that you would have a machine for that at home. So you will just lose out for that part of the points, but there are still points up for grabs for completing the theoretical part of that physiology lab. The other thing that I wanted to share, and again, I do print you these lab worksheets ahead of the time, so you can get them physically when you attend the lab. But if you were not in attendance, you will actually find the lab worksheet here as well. I've made it available for you, and you can just simply access it in an electronic form. Like I said, I accept submissions in many formats, but as long as it's uploaded to the Canvas, it can be hand-completed version that you just take a picture of and upload to Canvas. It can be hand-completed, you scan it. It can be electronically completed on your computer, and then you upload that file back to me. The file that I share with you is a doc file, so it's a Word document file, so you're able to edit it as well with great ease. One thing that I want to start with and just make a note for anyone, if you did receive a printed out version of the EKG lab from me, there is a little typo that remains from the earlier versions that I had. So I've uploaded this electronic version that you can see now, but the version that I printed was a little earlier on. So there's an error on the very last question, question 3, that asks you to, using your EKG strip, calculate your heart rate. And to calculate the heart rate, how you do it is 60 over RR interval. So what you're seeing on the screen now is correct. The printed version that I handed out, there is an error in that calculation. So rather than what's written on the printed version, use this version that you see on the screen to calculate heart rate, measure the RR interval, and then divide 60 by RR interval to get your heart rate in beats per minute. So 60 over RR interval is the way to get that answer. So I just wanted to share it and remind about that and put it out there so that you've got what you need to succeed on that lab as well. And let's go back here. So what I'd like to do as the next thing is to discuss through the EKG lab, and we'll also have a quick look of the dissection, even though you're not going to be completing it, but in case you're trying to remind yourself what happened there or study independently for that. So let me share my screen from yesterday's lab class. And of course, it should be week 4, just updating that part that has slipped through my radar. So let's have a look together what we want to remember from there. And I really want to start, like I said, by looking at this EKG lab. EKG lab is more of a physiological lab, whereas the actual dissection part is going to be more of a anatomical component of the labs for this chapter on the heart. So, as you might remember from our lecture content, EKG is a method that we can use to get understanding of this electrical conduction process that's taking place within the heart. And in particularly what you see from there is that are things that we're expecting to happen present there? Are they at appropriate spacing of what we're expecting to see? And especially on this one, are they regular? Or are we missing pieces? Is there something extra? And also the shape of the events that we're expecting to see on the trace. So all of these characteristics give us an idea of the summation of these electrical impulses that are passing through various parts of the heart and whether this electrical conduction network is working appropriately. Are the electrical signals passing to all parts correctly in a right order, at the right amplitude, at the right time? And if there were any issues with this conduction network, we would really start to see that on the EKG. And what's pretty remarkable is that typically when we use 12 leads to measure the EKG, we spread many of those across the chest, and that gives us almost like 12 different snapshots of the same thing. And having these 12 different snapshots allow us to have a bit more of a three-dimensional appreciation of these signals that we can pick from then 12 different locations. And that helps us to specify if there is a problem, where in the heart, we're in that conduction network, that problem would be. So that's why we use multiple leads in clinical practice. For our purposes on this lab, we will be using actually only 4 leads. That's gonna be plenty enough for us to manage. So of course you will realize that we're not gonna get clinical quality data. We are simply learning the concept of how to record an EKG trace and how to read the basics of that. We'll leave the more advanced stuff for later on, but I want you to have at least a basic appreciation of what's going on. And to complete the trace, I asked you to make sure that the key here is for success that you always have a good contact between the lead and the skin. If the contact is compromised, then you will not either get trace, or the trace that you will not get is not as good. So to improve this contact, I encourage you to make sure that you put the lead to a clean skin. So cleaning that with an alcohol wipes that were provided is recommended. People who have especially lots of hair, for example, that can become an issue that the lead doesn't attach nicely to the skin. We can have issues if the skin is very oily, very sweaty, and so on. So really doing your best to make sure that that connection there is a strong and good one so we can record that electrical trace. I also provided in the class, if you had issues to establish a good connection, I provided gel that can help with that, but that's what we take as a plan B if we don't with normal means accomplish that good connection. I asked you then to make sure that you position your leads appropriately, correctly, and I do realize that I have a slight mix up there with the colors and words. We're just gonna go with the with the diagram, what we're seeing here. So you position one, each limb, I guess, it receives one of the leads. So again, we're not getting as complete and as proper and as clinically valid view of the heart as possible, but we are getting something that's gonna be easier to accomplish and easier to read, just an overall summation of these electrical impulses. So once you've attached the leads and you've connected the machine correctly, the key is to be relaxed, sit quiet, so that we get a nice trace. If you're moving about a lot, if you're generating nervousness, for example, by being super, super concerned, is my heart beating correctly? The traces will be probably a little bit more all over the place and harder to read. So you want to be nice and relaxed. And what I would expect you to see is something that looks like the ideal trace that we have looked in the class. So in an ideal trace, you always see three main components. And then it's really looking at those three main components, what shape, what direction, what timing spaces, spacing they are, when we start to analyze these EKG traces. And in fact, in your lab, I am asking you to practice before you look at your own trace with just an ideal basic trace that I've provided for you here. And you're seeing the same trace here on the screen. And I wanted you to identify two basic elements from that and label them to the diagram that I provide. So what I've asked for you to do is to identify the P wave, the QRS complex, and T wave. And you can identify them on either one of these two sets of events that I've provided for you. So let's have a look of those together. So the first bump that we're seeing is gonna be the P wave. And you remember that the P wave tells you that the atrial fibers at the sinoatrial node are now depolarizing. So we can tell that event happening from this, this bump in the EKG trace. The next set of events is called QRS complex that represents set of three waves. So the first one is going to be our Q, second R, and the final one is going to be our S wave. Together, since they are so tightly, closely packed together, we refer to them as a QRS complex. And QRS complex really gave us a clue that when we see that when that's appearing, your ventricular fibers are now depolarizing. The final event of this cardiac cycle that we're looking at is the T wave. And T wave, when we see that, that is evidence of the ventricular fibers now repolarizing. So we reach the end of that full cardiac cycle. You remember the term cardiac cycle referred to one full round of a heartbeat. So there we have the three elements. And once you have identified these three elements, they help you to work out all of the intervals and segments that I was asking you to work out for. So let's have a look of those together, and I've listed them there below. So let's see how we can find them on that diagram. So we're going to start with the TR interval, so the distance between the T wave and R component of the QRS complex. Remember, the R component was the wave that came highest, so the middle wave. So you start from the middle and go to the middle, and that's your P interval. For QT interval, remember the Q element of the QRS complex was the first drop, first spike of this complex, and you measure the distance to the T element, T wave. Next one was RR interval, so from one highest peak to the next highest peak. That tells the length of the RR interval. We can also look at things such as PQ segment. So it's from the P wave to the Q wave of the QRS complex. We can also look at ST segment, from the last element of QRS complex to the T wave. And we can also look at TP segment, which is from the last bump of a single heart cycle, so the T wave, to the P wave, which was the first wave that we saw on the next heartbeat. So what's the delay between those two? So all of these are things that you can measure. And one thing that I do get sometimes students asking about, and that I just really, really want to make sure that I highlight properly, is that students sometimes wonder that, okay, well, how do I measure the duration of the P wave? So we had identified P wave was here. So you start from where you first start to see the P wave, and you measure how many boxes you have until you last see the P wave. So this would be the duration of the P wave. So this was all about counting how many boxes did you have between events that we looked at. And as you count those, the number of boxes becomes important, because we then have a scale for making a calculation of how long of a time period will each of these boxes represent. And we're going to see that as the next one. So each small box that you can see represents 0.04 seconds in time. Each of the large boxes that you will see represents 0.2 seconds in time. And 5 large boxes represents 1 second in time. So you will need to do a little bit of multiplication calculations to make sure that you convert that. Okay, let's say, for example, here we have a P wave. We see that it's 2 boxes in length. Well, each box represents 0.04 seconds. So to calculate the actual duration of the P wave, you would multiply, since we have 2 boxes, 2 times 0.04. And that, of course, gives us 0.08 seconds. Remember, it was this distance that we saw here. And similarly, you can do that for other elements, other intervals, other segments of the EKG trace. And once you've done that, you've received good practice of kind of labeling out things, and you do this analysis of your own EKG trace. One thing that students often run into is that it's hard to find the ideal trace, which one to look at from your own printed EKG trace from the lab. You do need to have a little bit of a fade of an eye to identify these elements. So just do your best looking for your P wave, your QRS complex, and for your T wave. And really use the trace, identify where you can see these easiest, pick and choose what works for you. And like I said, the final question that I had on the lab for the part that I'm asking you to submit for you, for me, from you, is the calculation of the heart rate. Do not rely on what the machine automatically tells you. There might be errors if you had before you filtered the traces that might have skewed the calculation that the machine has automatically done. So do it yourself. And what you're doing there, you're looking the distance from one peak to another peak. So from R to an under R, so RR interval. And that was what you used to divide 60 over the RR interval, and that gave you your heart rate. And that's what I'm asking you to report to me. I was also asking you to include a picture of your trace with the lab report, so you get the points for that. So we can check that everything kind of aligns with what we're expecting to see. So I believe that that really summarizes everything that I had to say about the EKG lab. And the next thing that I wanted to talk about was going to be our dissection activity. that we completed in the class. So let's have a look of the dissection activity a little bit and just go through what we saw, how we saw it, and what did that tell us. Please remember, though, that again, this is just a revision. It is something that we completed in the class, and if you were not able to take part, I'm afraid that there's very little I can do to provide you points for that part of the lab this week. One thing that I wanted to start with was to acknowledge that what you might see in textbook or what you might see in this presentation might not be a perfect fit with what you see when you are dissecting the heart that's being given to you, given for you to dissect. This is because there's a lot of things, both in general level, but in practicalities that play a role. So we remember that heart was kind of an odd one. It's not located aligning to any of the standard planes that we see in the body. It's kind of in an awkward angle. So we often talk about heart as if it was independent from the rest of the body when we're studying. Remember, heart is not fully symmetrical. There's a lot there going on. Sometimes it can be hard to tell the side. So we're going to have to do a little bit of further exploration to identify the left and right and so on. So other thing that I kind of is more of a practical one that I wanted to remind you is that often these hearts that you are going to dissect might look a little misshapen, or they might have gotten discolored, or they might have gotten a little stiffer than what they would be normally. This is all because we are using hearts that have had to be preserved and packaged and shipped to us. So in any of those steps, things might have taken place, things might have happened, and that might have an impact on your unique heart that you're working with. And of course, the key underlying reason why we do dissections, there's always the element of individual variation that we see from one individual to another. And that's really the richness and beauty of doing these dissections, that you kind of want to be comparing what your group's heart looks like compared to others in a class and see how much variation we actually see. One thing that's kind of, again, going to that individuals are different. There's a different amount of fat tissue, different amount of scarring, different amount of connective tissue around each of the heart. So like individuals differ, so do the animals that we get these hearts from. And the hearts that you will be using or you used were pig hearts, so they're a very good representation that's comparable to what we see on the humans. So I just wanted to put it out there. But really, my recommendation is that you use all of the tools, all of the information that you have available to orientate yourself properly with that heart before you jump on to the other steps of the lab. I think one of the quotes that I sometimes see being used that is that you need to experience the heart. So there's a lot more than just looking. It's about feeling. It's about following pathways. It's about working out things as such. So do not hesitate to take that time to figure out what's going to go happen and what's going to go on. So let's start by looking at the heart and the general orientation. There is typically on the hearts that we have been working recently, quite a bit of adipose tissue around them. So you might need to do some trimming, as sometimes it's not worth of going crazy of cleaning it unless you have a lot of time. The other thing that sometimes my students find useful is either by using the probes that I provided that you can use to show different parts of the organ. You should never use a sharp knife or scissors to point out structures. You should use tools that have been provided for that, or you can use the colored pencils that I have provided to follow the paths of different vessels. As sometimes once you've identified one, it's easier to leave it there, the pencil, so you can use that as a landmark and come back to that once you have that information. So just get started on the orienting yourself around the heart. I asked you to do three things. I asked you to identify the pulmonary trunk, the auricles, so the flaps of the of our atrias, and identifying the coronary sinus that ran along the surface of the heart in an angle separating the atrias and ventricles and all that good stuff. So let's have a look of what we're going to see here. So here I have a view of the front or ventral side of the heart, and then I have a view of the back side of the heart as well. And we can see our pulmonary trunk coming out from here nicely. And we see this flap of an auricle here on this nicely cleaned view of the heart. Remember, these auricles were often empty and flattened flaps there, but when the blood pulled up and filled the atria, they can expand, kind of giving us extra reservoir, extra space where the blood can go. So a little bit bigger of a picture of the structures that I just pointed out, pulmonary trunk and our auricle there on the heart. If you look at the backside of the heart, the view is very different. So again, take the time to figure out what is front, what is back. Take the time to figure out the basics, because then everything else will be easier. The next thing that I asked you to do was to use your finger to really figure out of the four openings that we had, that which one is which one. So using your fingers, figure out where each of those is going from the top of the heart, and identify the pulmonary vein, which is going to go to our right ventricle. Try to identify also aorta, that's going to be located behind that and may be covered with fat at times. And the next thing that I wanted you to also notice is the wall thickness difference between left and right ventricle. You remember, right ventricle pump the blood to the pulmonary circulation, so to the lungs, so it doesn't need to be as forceful. So the right ventricle is going to have a thinner wall, whereas left ventricle pump the blood to all other parts of the body, so to the systemic circulation. So we need a lot of force there, and left ventricular wall is much, much, much thicker. So take the time to feel that difference, observe that difference, and make sure that you can tell that apart. And here we can see nicely a pulmonary vein has been identified with the finger. And you can also see the pulmonary artery, brachiocephalic, and aorta, some of the major vessels that I asked you to identify. What many students prefer to do is to label these as you work them out and mark them with pencils so that you can kind of keep coming back and identify them again. So here that's been nice, done nicely. You can see the pulmonary trunk that has been labeled. So leaving at the heart, going to the lungs, you can see your brachiocephalic, your aorta, your vena cava, and your pulmonary vein. So once you have those on place, it's easier to orientate yourself and come back to these structures. What I asked you to do next is to actually open the heart, to be able to have a look of the inner structures that we will find. So I was asking you to try to follow the superior vena cava and pulmonary vein as your guiding guidelines, and cut the heart into half to show the chambers. There's a nice picture of identifying where the cuts are. And once you do these cuts, that allows you to open the heart on both sides to see a lot of the structures that we have internally. So we will see our right side and we will see our left side. We will see the right ventricle, left ventricle, the big thickness difference. Notice how the right has thinner wall, left has much thicker wall, and you can start to see some of the bulbs, some of the adaptations on the chamber walls, and of course the interventricular septum as well. So I think that this is particularly good view to illustrate the thickness difference between the thin right ventricle and thick left ventricle. So you'll really see this difference as a consequence of their functions, consequence of the pressure that the blood must leave the heart with. And we see our interventricular septum. We could also see really nicely our valve with the cord and tendineae running to the papillary muscles. So remember, these were the adaptations that prevented the valve from flipping backwards when the force was very high. So we found these cord and tendineae and papillary muscles only on our AV valves because the ventricles generated such a power. We don't find those on our semilunars. Another thing that's really nicely obvious on this diagram is this bumpy inner wall of the ventricles. We will see it on both. And this was to prevent blood from pooling inside the heart to these places. I asked you to work as a team. You might need actually two hands to see everything, one to help to kind of open up inside the heart, other one to actually point them out. You might want to use colored pencils to follow where they opened, so you saw them from outside, but where are they actually kicking in inside the heart? And notice the two main things that I mentioned, the thickness difference between left and right ventricle and the valves and the structures that go with the valves as well. And here we have a really nice dissection view. So I've kind of included it there for you to see as well. So we're seeing the valve, we're seeing the atrium and ventricle, and again, atrium and ventricle. So on the right-hand side and on the left-hand side. Here is a very particularly beautiful view showing the valves, showing the cord and tendineae, and showing the papillary muscle. So remember, there's going to be differences between each heart. There's going to be differences between groups, what groups we'll see. So it is good idea to take the time to go and see what other lab groups on your class have found, what they have discovered. And I encourage you to take those pictures and share them with each other. And I also promise that if you send me pictures, you will get some extra credit for it. So that really summarizes everything that I had planned to say in terms of reviewing the lab and lab material that we covered this week. I hope it has been helpful. I hope it has kind of assisted you on noticing the key points of what you might want to know as it relates to this week's material. And that's going to kind of wrap up and finish everything that I had prepared for this session. I think that this has been a very useful to just take a little bit of time as a revision, as a reminder of what we've seen. And I believe that in the evening session, then we have time to go through a little bit more of the theoretical side of the lecture material. Unless something else comes up, I'm always open to take these sessions wherever you want to go with those. Like I've said, these sessions are for you. They are very flexible. They are here to meet your needs. So please, please, please let me know where I can help. So I'm going to wrap up this session here for today. Thank you for joining me. Thank you for all of your hard work. I was especially impressed with your work on the exams last week. So make sure you take a little time to also look at all of the little comments that I wrote for you individually on your exams and practicals. So you get the most out of that. Having said that, thank you again, and I will see you in the evening session if you so choose to join me at that time. Until next time, thank you and bye.